You know, you kind of went around there 47. But Ted, of course, is a legend in the bike industry. He's one of our judges for many, many years, and he has a wealth of knowledge about bike racing way before Lance. Let's face facts. There were actually bike races before Lance, and they were pretty darn good bike races as well. So I'd like to bring Ted Ernst. Come on up, Ted. Woo!
Riding with multi-speeds and derailleurs and all that, but U.S. guys were riding fixed gears in 25, 50, 100-mile bike races. That's just the way it was. So as a result, then, why did that happen? And so we'll show you pictures of all these races and races during the time, and I'll try, because I know a lot of the people that were racing and that are on the pictures, and I'll give you a couple of personal anecdotes about these people, what they did for a living, where they were, stuff like that, if that's of interest to you, to give you a little more intimate feeling with how the cycling history came about, what you are all part and parcel of, and how you are now also part of that cycling lore and history as it went through our 100 years plus of time in cycling as it is. Now we're more continental, using multi-speeds and all the new stuff, but years ago, up until even into the 60s, guys were still riding 10, 25 mile races in big 1 mile courses in the parks on track bikes. So that's just the way the rules were, and that's what you did. Okay, so let me get off of the stage here. High air is getting to my altitude sickness, and we'll start the program. We don't want to put you guys to sleep. We want to keep you awake and live because we got to work up your appetite. If you're going to be riding, you're going to feel yourself in the bike races, and then you can work up an appetite so you can really devastate the dinner we're going to have in a little bit. All right, folks. Enjoy the Eroica. Thanks to Wes. Okay, so here we are. We're going to start out with just to give a little history. In the 1880s and 90s, you see right here a really nice picture of all the guys on their high wheelers, and this is kind of the start of cycling in that time frame in the United States, a little bit before, but this is one of the earlier pictures that I have. And of course, in the 1890s, in that time frame, horse racing and boxing and cycling were really the only game in town. They were the biggest sports that were there, period. And then as the automobile started coming in 1900, then it didn't take long for the planes and the motors and all that to start taking over. And then it really kind of died between 1905 and World War I. So then I'll try to bring you, you know, through that period into that time, so you'll have a good feel as to what was happening and why it happened. Okay, maybe we can go to the next. Here we go. So here's a meet in Iowa, and I don't know how well you can see it, but there's a bunch of small wheel bikes, more like safety bicycles in the front, and then to the vents and the safeties in the back, and in the foreground, there's a couple of kids and ladies, you know, with their long skirts and on their, you know, full-size frames. And of course, they have the music in the front, because in that time frame, John Philip Sousa and all that stuff was very popular, and it was kind of a martial theme that happened in those years as the cycling and the bike racing was going in full bore for Fillmore, as it were. Okay, there we go. There's a guy named William Bloom. His nickname was Farmer because his parents had a farm, like many people did in the agricultural society, and he's riding an 1899 Manson bicycle. And the Manson company was a Chicago firm where William Bloom was from, and they were in business from about 1895 to 1900, and then of course so many of these bike companies died because the cars started to come in and the bike race was over. Now, William Bloom was so good, they wanted him to turn professional, but he was making so much money as an amateur. Now, think about this, winning diamond stick pins and automobiles and grand pianos for first place prizes in 1900, in his time frame, 1895, in 50 and 100 mile road races. And he used to tell the guys, "Well, boys, when you see daylight between my back wheel and your front wheel, you're never going to see me again." And that's what he told the people. And his brother Emil had a ride with him. And if this guy got the flat tire, Emil had to get off his bike and give his bicycle, because he would win the bike race and he'd get the big prize. And they were selling, you know, cars off and do whatever they had to do at that time. They had a, you know, a regular cup full of diamond stick pins, ties, all that stuff. They just did very well as so-called amateur cyclists in the time frame. Okay? There you go. Here's Al Flatt. Now, this is normally a Jeffrey 1895 tandem. And Al Flatt and his friend Al Langer, they rode tandem races and bicycles all the time. And this is probably taken at half day's horse ride out of Chicago, where you see the barn in the background. And they ride the tandem out there on the old dirt roads. And when you're riding tomorrow at the Eroica, you can see the roads in a little bit. You see the dirt in the front. That's what those guys rode on. And you'll be riding in a very similar atmosphere and vein tomorrow, re-experiencing that thrill and the agony and the sheer fun of suffering out there on the old dirt roads. And Al was he still holds records today for ice skating at Johnson & Johnson Ice Skates. And the guys used to tell me, because these guys came in my shop, I mean, I'm going to be 85 in a couple of weeks, and these guys are, you know, in their 20s, like right at the turn of the century. And he told me, yeah, that, you know, we used to ride on the cobblestone streets, and then the streetcar tracks were horse-drawn still at the time in Chicago. And then they had a couple inches wide, maybe 6, 7, 8 inches wide of cedar blocks along the streetcar tracks that were horse-drawn, and they used to ride on the cedar tracks. And then when he got into a good rhythm and they felt good, the streetcar tracks were a little over 2 inches wide, these little horse-drawn carriages. And then they tried to get the tandem up on that 2.5 inch or so, 3 inch wide rail, and ride on the steel rail down the middle of the street for practice. So that's the way it was. And when they'd ride along in the dirt road, the guy in the front would signal to the guy in the back, bump, rut, and then so the guy in the back could adjust the seat and his knees and ankles to compensate for the steering problem that they had. And they were so smart on these old bikes years ago that I restored a few. They had different spoke lengths between the front and back wheel because of the crossing. So they figured out that if they would use a different spoke crossing in the front versus the back, they could use the same spoke. That's how, I mean, different guys were pretty dumb in the turn of the century. You have to, you know, pat him credit for not trying to figure that out. Next, here we go. Here's Al's buddy, Al Langer. And Al Langer was a really good bike rider, and they rode the tandem all the time. This looks like a kind of an oiled dirt road, and that's, you know, nice big balloon tires on that old tandem. Now, my buddy Ziggy and I, in 1950, we had this tandem that Al Flatt loaned to us, and we had it in our shop for about 20 years. We actually raced this tandem in Soldier's Field in Chicago on the quarter mile track, and we got second place in a tandem bike race with a 50-year-old tandem against guys with brand new Schmidt Bearmont tandem that were on the Olympic team. And the guys couldn't believe it. Oh, goddamn tandem, what are you doing here? So we just had great fun with it. But it was a beautiful old bicycle. And Oscar Watson has it, Oscar Watson Jr. He has it in his shop now, because when Al Flatt passed away and my dad had moved away from Chicago to California, where we are now, why, then he went over to Oscar's and gave them the tandem, and that's hanging up on his wall now in the store in his shop in Chicago.
Fullerton
Avenue, yep. Okay. Anyway, here's Langer. He's on a single speed bicycle. Now, if you talk about an Eroica road, how about that? There you go. That's what you're gonna ride on tomorrow, and that's the fun of it. And as you look at these bikes, you can see that they're not that much different from today's bicycles. And they just rolled along, and they had a great time on those bikes. In fact, a little bit after this was taken, you're getting into that 1905, 1910 type time, bikes almost died. And the old man Langer, he used to tell us that if he'd be riding down the street on a bicycle in Chicago, and kids would throw stones at him. Yeah, look at a funny guy on a bike. So that shows you how the mood changed in the United States from cycling craze in the 1890s to the 1910s, when it was almost dead. On the road and on the track, just a little bit on the track, but then very little on the road, other than a few races that were kind of classics that they held. Okay. There you go. So now we're making a transition from me that, because I don't have much of the 20s, but this is a Joliet Chicago bike race. It's a 40-mile race that started in Joliet. We rode on the main roads, all traffic stopped, and we could see Joliet on the name on the building there, and then everybody's riding a fixed gear. And a lot of these races were scratch races, but then some were handicapped. And they usually had four packs. They had limits, second pack, and then they called it dog mark, because you weren't good enough to catch your front guys maybe, but not good enough to stay away from the scratch men who were behind you. And they usually had 4, 5, 6 minutes in between the fields. And then they had places for fast time, and then they gave places for the places in the first place. So the guys in scratch wanted to catch everybody and ride fast time and get one prize, but they caught the guys way in the front on limit, then they would get two prizes. So that was a really hard way to ride, but it was good competition. And then that's the Joliet Chicago.
And also that there were no brakes fixed gear.
Oh, and remember, these are no brakes fixed gear.
On the road race.
Fixed gear, no brakes. If you came with a brake, they would take you out of the race. You had a free wheel, you couldn't ride. It was fixed gear only all the way across the board. So you have to see guys riding on the road. They used to take it, they were thirsty, they had a water bottle, didn't have anything, they had to stick it on, tape it on their handlebar. They took oranges and taped it on the handlebar, ripped the tape off and sucked on the orange, whatever. And sometimes the guys would be racing in these races back in the 30s, and my dad was telling me, yeah, you know, we're riding along and we got hungry, so we stopped at a farmer's field, jumped over the fence, grabbed a couple apples, and got back on a bike and chased them. They ate the apples, because that's just the way it was. They had no support, and then it was just kind of fun. All good hard riding during the depression time. Here we go. This is just before the start, and this is the Danish American Cycling Club. Now the second guy from the left is my dad, and then the guy second from the right is Charlie Xeno. And Charlie Xeno was a six-day pro, and he turned professional later on, and he raced all these years, and of course, except for time in the service, still went too, and then into the 40s, until you know the end of the 40s, and came back to about 1950. And he was a contemporary of my dad. And the guy who was third place is my dad. The guy in second place is Charlie Wonders. And Charlie Wonders, later on, he was married, he didn't get into the Second World War until the end, and then he worked at Schwinn, and he was a foreman on the second shift, on the day shift in the Schwinn company on the assembly line in Chicago on Kilbourne Avenue, the original Schwinn factory. So this is a pretty good chunk of history here as to how the guys looked. Remember, to look at the bikes now, no brakes, fixed gear, 40-mile road race, and as you see it before the start. All right, here you go, same year, Humboldt Park. Look at the crowd, look at the clothing, the hats, the ladies, the men. And this is a big, long field, fixed gear, 25-mile, 1933 Chicago bike race in Humboldt Park on a 2-mile course. And everything was on their fix. Nobody had any brakes, and you just pedaled all the time, and that was it. So there we go. So that kind of brings you back. Ah, there we go. Here's the finish of one of those races. And if you look at sixth place, the guy at the beret, that's my dad getting sixth place. And he would try to break away from the guys, but he wasn't quite always strong enough to get away. But then he wasn't fast enough by the sprint either. And he was actually more a longer distance guy. But then, so the guy would beat him in a sprint, but he was always in the money, and he just had fun riding with all those guys. And then a year later, he opened up his shop in Chicago, which is, of course, where I grew up. There you go. There's some ladies riding, and there again, the two gals on the right and the gals on the left are all the same club, the Danish American Cycling Club. And a lot of these ethnic groups back in those years actually had cycling and soccer ball and or other athletic exercises. And this is gals on their track bikes. That's the races they rode, fixed gear. And this is in Sherman Park in Chicago. That's a 1 mile around the lagoon and in a racing course there. And they, of course, rode along with the men at different races of their own category. Okay, now here's 1938. Again, same kind of bicycles. And this is in front of my dad's shop. And at that time, the bike thing was not that big. This is towards the end of Depression time. And you see the board sharpened and repaired. Well, my dad knew how to do that. And then for sale up on the right-hand side, we had to sell model airplanes and other kind of little gliders and that stuff to make ends meet in the bike shop. And again, here's these guys that were in the club. The guy on the right-hand side name is Frank Smith. He died in the Second World War in a plane crash. The guy on the left is Charlie Bush. And he was in the military briefly. And And then the guy in the middle is my dad. And then the guys on the left there is Charlie Wanders, who was working at, for my dad for a while, and worked in the Swiss factory. And the guys were riding Diamant and Dirkop bicycles. I think the first and last bike are Diamant, German bikes, and then the bike next to it, the bike in the middle there, the Dirkop bikes. And oh yeah, the Matt just reminded me, you see that black window in the front? Down in the bottom by the sidewalk? That's a cold chute. And when you get cold, they had boilers in the basement, and when you got cold years ago, why then they dumped the glowing coal right in the sidewalk, and you'd come out and you shovel it down into the basement into your coal bin, because your boiler was downstairs, and you could shovel it from the coal bin into your boiler and into your building, and the radiator got warm. And we are 1945. This is the Edison Park Bike Race. It was a club that, you know, my dad started and belonged to. And again, this is a 48-mile handicap. We had four fields, and then it was all track bike, and then that's how the entry blank was. I think it says on our entry blank 50 cents or a dollar compared to today, but then that was big money at the time, and the post entries doubled, and then as a result, that's the way we signed them up. And then this is the start of the scratch pack, and I can identify a lot of these guys, and if I can get my page going here, I might even remind myself who they are. But in that picture, you see guys who actually were top riders in the United States. And I guess in this here, you're looking at, on the right-hand side, way on the right is Art Lauf. And Art Lauf was the best around rider back in the 40s. And he and his brother, Jimmy Lauf, who was national champion in 1946, I believe, in San Diego, they rode races all through the years. And the guy holding up Art Lauf on the right-hand side is Joe Berlando. And Joe Berlando was Frankie Berlando's brother, and he was the main striper who did all the beautiful Paramount striping for many years. Well, that's Joe Berlando, was the top bike rider in the 30s, and then right at the end of the 30s and after the war, he did a lot of the Schwinn Paramount striping. All that beautiful fork and framework, he was did a lot of it. Now next to the guy over on the left, the second guy from the left, that is Frankie Berlando. That's Joe Berlando's brother, and Frankie was on the 52, and I believe the 56 Olympic team, and second or third place in the national championship, and he was a scratch rider all the time. And then I guess the next guy over looks like, might be Pesek, and that's Irv Pesek, that's Fred's brother. It's Fred Pesek, Irving Pesek's brother, who's a famous six-day bike rider. And then the guy, I guess it's not a picture here. For some reason, you have to excuse me. I got temporary brain fade. And I'd have to see.
The guy with the sailor?
Yeah, no, not the guy with the sailor. The guy in the middle there, I think that's, that might be. Yeah, that's Bill Johann. And he was a Chicago rider. And then the next guy over is Pierre Devies. And the man holding him was an expat from Belgium. He had to come to this country because of the Nazi takeover in Belgium in the Second World War, and his sons came with him, and they started racing here, of course, because of the terrific Belgium tradition of bike racing, and that was the eldest son, Pierre. So then that was him holding him, and this guy's doing scratch. And then the next guy, there's Tom Miller. He was a Chicago guy, and he was training pretty good. And then the next guy over, I think, oh yeah, the next guy over is, the Pierre and his brother, Jimmy DeVries. I can't remember his brother's name. He was the younger of the DeVries brother. And then you see the guy in the Navy uniform holding him up. And then there's a guy to the left of him, is Sunny Bergman, another Chicago A-class rider. And then the guy with the hat looking backwards is Old Man Lauf. And that was Jimmy and Art Lauf's dad. We don't know what his first name was, but it was Old Man Lauf. That's what everybody called. And that was George Hensel, who was from the Deschamps Cycle Club of the Belgian clubs. And next to him was Gene Lechter, who was a gunsmith by trade, and his dad holding him, that was Old Man Lechter. And Gene Lechter there was a Wisconsin state champ, along with those guys that were racing back in the late 40s and all through the 50s. And only two guys got helmets, you see. You look at it, there were no helmets mandatory at that time until the later crash, that came in the late 40s, when a guy got killed either in Columbus or in Dayton. and then Chicago had a bad accident, and then they passed a law, he had a helmet law after 1950s, in the 50s, but then they didn't always enforce it either. Okay, here we go, 1946, St. Louis. This is the George Wilton Memorial, and that's the start of the race in 1946. And my dad is in there, that's the second pack, and you can see all through, everybody on a fixed gear, and 40 or 50 mile handicap, and then they just were all lined up, and it's a Soo Line Railroad, you know, trails there in the background, and you see these guys getting ready to go for the start, and a 48 mile handicap. So again, a picture, photo image of racing in 1946, but all fixed gear. And I think the reason for a lot of this was is that we never grew out of the Depression time when you couldn't afford road bikes, and all the guys had was a single speed bike. So they never imported much on the European bikes, so nobody could afford them other than a single speed bike. And everyone was riding 6-day bike races or track races. There was no road racing extent as such much. A road race here, road race there. They may have 10 a year, and in one of each major cycling community, but then that was it. The rest was all park racing and small races, but none of any big large dispute. So you got through the Depression time and the 6-day bike racing, which was really famous along with the marathon effect, you know, flagpole sitting and dance-a-thons and all that stuff. But that was all indoor board track racing, but this outdoor stuff was few and far between, and guys only had one bike, and it was all fixed gear. We never transitioned into multi-speed racing from the original 1890s of those old high wheelers until the 50s started coming along. Here we go. This is not far from your San Jose road race, and the guys here are riding out there on the highway someplace out there in San Jose, you know, out the flats. And again, they're on the highway, the cars are coming by them, and this is one of the fields, all fixed gear, no brakes. See high flange hubs, block chains, whatever you had. Yeah, there's long, deep bars, a really curved track bar on the road. You're down in drops, and that was it. You're riding, just going for full bore, and that's the way everybody rode. You know, you were just riding, just changing baseline, setting pace, going as hard as you could, fixed gear, one speed. Most of the guys running, well, at that time, it was inch pitch, so you're running 25.8 or 26.8, the 50 or 52.16 were probably the gears. Occasionally, the guys would ride 24-7, 48, 14, but that was a pretty high gear, or a sprinting gear, or then they rode 23-7, but that was a little bit low, because then you start getting into 78 inches, so they'd spun you off the wheel. So they need to ride, you know, that 84, 88, 90 inch gear racer to keep the good pace going in these handicap races. Here you go. Now here's an interesting, here we're getting into the transition of United States racing. You see some road bikes and some track bikes here. On the far right is Claire Young, Roger Young's dad. He raced in the 30s and 40s. You see him on his road bike there. It's probably a Yarago road bike. And then you see in the on the left-hand side, I think it's a guy from Kenosha, and he got first. And then the guy in the middle is Jimmy Thompson on he had a, I think, a Paramount or a Watson track bike. And then you're looking back, I think there's a guy named Johnny Milken from Kenosha. He had a road bike. And if you see the in the helmet that just kind of partially hit in the back, believe it or not, that's Ray Gajarowski of Romic Bicycles. And he was a good top road rider, but again, didn't have the top sprints. And he was always get fourth, fifth, sixth in the sprints, maybe eighth, but he was always in there. He rode into Mexico and stuff like that. So these are really good, good bike riders for this American scene in a transition time between fixed gear and road gear racing derailleur. 8-speed type stuff. Now, this motley looking crew is in 1952 in the back of our shop in Chicago, and the guy on the left is my dad, and we were selling Yaragos at that time. The second guy's name was Bob Jensa, and everybody called him Shaky, because when he got in the bike, he'd pull out a bar like a wild man, he'd swing back and forth. So if you sat on his wheel, you're lucky you didn't get knocked on your butt. So everybody said, get off his wheel, go ride a straight line, they're all swearing at him. But that was Shaky, and he was a crazy guy. These guys would go out to the bars and they'd stay till 2, 3 o'clock, and the police would arrest them. Somebody would bail them out at 4 in the morning. They'd show up at the bikers at 8 o'clock, you know, and half hung over and out of jail. Once or twice a year was common practice, but that was Bob there having a good time, and they just lived life to the full. And I'm next to third place there. And then his first guy is the name Cliff Rasmussen, and he was a contender for the 1940 Olympic team, but they called the coast was off because of the Second World War. And Ross Danielson there in the middle, and he was a guy who was a